When I was a little bitty boy, my grandmother bought me a cute little toy.
Who does it? Stars do it.
I rear-ended a lady.
I rear-ended her hard.
Ma'am, I'm sorry that, yes, I did hit your car, but I'm insured.
I got cracked.
All right, and we're back with DrinkinAZ, and we have a special edition of the Dunk Tank. Duncan, how you doing?
I'm good, thanks.
Awesome. We have with us Sharon Coombs. Coombs or Combs?
Coombs.
Coombs. Sharon Coombs. And she is a representative from VOS Vintage. And we're, you know, down here in the cellar. And one of the things that they have going on simultaneously while we're having our show, they have a little concert going on in the back. And they also have
a wine tasting.
Yeah. So, and you're the wine tasting part of that. So tell us a little bit about, you know, your company and what you do.
I work for Valley of the Sun Vintage Selections, which is the fine wine division of Southern Wine and Spirits of Arizona. Southern Wine and Spirits is one of the two largest beer, wine, and liquor distributors in Arizona, Alliance Beverage being the other largest. My division, just on its own, is the number three largest fine wine distributor in the state. So
nice.
I have the pleasure of selling a number of different really nice boutique wines from all over the world.
Nice. Before we get into that, I want to take it back a little bit. So, are you an Arizona gal?
Yes. Born and raised, second generation.
Really? Nice. Awesome. And where did you go to high school?
Fountain Hills.
Okay. So, are you from the Fountain Hills area?
My mom moved when she was in high school. Her family moved from Ohio to Fountain Hills in the early 70s.
Uh-huh.
And my dad's family, my dad was born and raised in Mesa, grew up in Arizona.
Uh-huh.
And so when my mom and dad got together and then I came about, I ended up growing up in Fountain Hills.
Okay, great. Yeah. So, you know, we're all about local, keeping it local. So it's nice to have a local girl that we're talking to. So what got you into the wine industry?
Well, I actually went to bartending school, of all things, which is actually sort of a joke in the industry.
I did that, too. It was fun.
It was fun.
Yes.
And I did it solely because I had a week free.
I did it just for the hell of it.
Exactly. I did it just for the hell of it. A friend of mine was doing it, and he was doing it with the intention of getting into the business, but I had zero interest in working in restaurants or bars or anything of that nature. But after I had gone through bartending school and had been out of it for a while, to say I graduated, it's sort of a loose term because it's really only a week and a half class. But several months later.
And the homework is awesome, too.
Exactly, yes. Yeah. I did it, you know, with the intention of thinking, well, at least I can make drinks at parties and my friends will think I'm super cool for that. But a few months after I had finished it, the instructor called me and said, hey, I'm the food and beverage director at this little resort up in Fountain Hills, and I remember you from class, and I really enjoyed working with you, and I was wondering where you're bartending currently. And I laughed at her because I'd never worked in a restaurant other than folding pizza boxes when I was, you know, eight or something, you know, for a family friend. But she said, well, it's okay, you don't have any experience. I know I can teach you everything you need to know. Just come down and apply. And so I went and I started out as a pool bartender at Copperwind in Fountain Hills, and then quickly figured out that the fine dining servers at night made more money than pool servers during the day, and it was air conditioned. So the fastest way to get from the pool to the dining room was to learn about wine. And then once I started learning, it just sort of took on a life of its own.
So would you say this is a passion for you?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
Nice.
Now, it's funny, though. She learned about wine that way. I learned about wine in the Marine Corps because my palate is very, very just
impeccable.
Carlos Rossi is possibly the best wine that I ever had 23 years ago.
Right. Well, so, if you liked it, it was good.
Because $5, you got a huge jug, and you could literally flip it back like a hillbilly and just get stupidly drunk on, I don't know, like turpentine.
Oh, wow. So,
but I digress.
Luckily, I never had any of those experiences, but a few wine reps came into the restaurant and did trainings with us and talked about the flavor components in the wines, and we actually, one of the trainings that we did in particular resonated with me, where they had added, say, vanilla or lemon or wood flavorings to the wine to enhance your ability to perceive it. And that's when it started to click, of all these things that people were talking about and using, words they were using to describe wine really started to make sense for me. And then once I got into it, it just snowballed and I wanted to learn more and more, and I studied and I traveled and worked at better and better restaurants.
And I asked you when I met you, I said, are you the sommelier? And you kind of looked at me, gave me a strange look. So you're not quite certified yet, or?
Well, sommelier is a weird word in the industry.
Duncan, I can't even say it right.
Sommelier.
Sommelier.
Yeah.
And that is not an ethnic.
It's not Somalian.
Yeah.
No, not Somalian. Somali. Lots of TV shows will say that to make a joke. The Somalian's here, and she knows all about wine. but no, sommelier, it's a term that I believe is often misused, but it really just depends on your perception of the word or the application for the word, because it can be a job title. A person who is the sommelier of a place is basically whoever is in charge of selecting the wines that are going to be sold and then assisting customers with choosing the right wine for them. So in a restaurant setting, you don't technically need any certifications to be the sommelier for that restaurant.
So it's a title.
It's a title, a job title.
In that sense.
Exactly. Right. But then there is a guild of sommeliers and a court of master sommeliers, and going through those levels of tests and getting to higher and higher levels where you actually can call yourself a master sommelier at the highest level is a whole different
thing. Where are you on that journey?
Currently with the court of master sommeliers, I have taken the introductory level, so level one of four levels, because it goes introductory, certified, advanced, and master. Okay. But then I've also done some tests with other organizations. So, for example, the Society of Wine Educators. Through them, I am a certified specialist of wine.
Nice.
Wow.
It's good. And I have good credentials.
Yeah. Well, it's helpful to just give yourself. It helps other people understand what you've done in terms of studying.
We just found our wine expert.
Yeah, definitely looking for a wine expert for the show.
Oh.
Tell us about pairing. And that's what wine is really, it seems to be, to me, seems to be more about pairing than anything else.
Yes. Yes and no. I mean, again, with anything with wine, there's always the exception. Food and wine were always consumed together, traditionally in the old world. We are the first country, really, to drink wine as a cocktail, and a lot of Europeans think that's strange. So the natural pairing of food and wine goes back as long as there's been wine.
Well, they can just, you know, they can deal with it because we're America and
we do whatever
we do
want.
It's correct.
Exactly. Yes. So, but food and wine pairing can be really simple, or you can make it very complicated. Basically, if the wine is good and the food is good, then the pairing will probably work. If you like what you're eating and you like what you're drinking, then you'll be fine. But if you want to get into the details of, you know, certain sauces and certain ingredients and certain wines have this subtlety, or they have more acid or less acid or more tannin, or the tannin goes well with proteins, and so that's why Cabernets go with steaks, then you can make it as complicated as you want.
Exactly. That's what I was thinking.
So I was
Duncan
cheated.
And I just looked at each other like she was talking in
Gibberish.
Trigonometry right there.
Yeah, I think I was cheated this whole time with my boxed wine. And Mad Dog 2020.
Perhaps. Yeah.
You know, I think I stunted my growth on the whole wine thing when I had a couple 4-packs of California coolers back when they actually had wine in them. And smoked a pack of Swisher Sweet cigars and then proceeded to empty it out all over the place.
Yeah.
And I was done with wine at that point. But I'm willing to give it a shot. I like wine with Italian food. Like, I have really good Italian food. I can't drink beer with it.
Right.
Beer just doesn't marry up well with Italian food.
No. And in general, the most basic rules that I like to keep in mind when I'm thinking about what to drink with what I'm eating is think about what they do in the place where the food comes from. So Italy is known for beer in a very small way. You know, they do have some nice Italian, there are some nice Italian beers, but they drink beer by itself.
Right.
When they eat food, they drink wine.
Right.
If you're in Germany, on the other hand, and although they have great wines, Rieslings and so forth, you generally think of Gewürztraminer, yes. But you generally think of German food, heavy fried foods, sauerkraut and things like that,
right,
going better with beer. And the beers that they're known for are amazing.
Yes.
So
we like a dessert wine, my wife and I. We're a big fan of those.
Yeah. Dessert wine's great. I mean, I actually get sort of sad when people say, oh, I don't like sweet wines. Well, some of the best wines in the world are sweet wines from, you know, the Bordeaux region of France, a nice Sauternes that it's very sweet, but it's so well balanced that it's not like a cheap sweet wine that has fake sugar added so that you don't notice that it doesn't taste good.
So, you know, maybe I'm thinking, Duncan, like just on the fly here, if we could get Sharon to, you know, meet up with us again and maybe cut some spots for us, she could do like the ABCs of wine.
Well, that's the thing.
Because we have a lot of craft beer people that's our main target, who, you know, we know the complexities and everything about beer, and so we're not oblivious to the fact that the complexities exist for wine. We just don't know them. So
very
we could use a little bit of schooling on that.
Yeah, we definitely could use the education in the. And the talented person who could definitely...
So what kind of wine were you showcasing tonight here at Sundevil?
Tonight I had a nice variety, and I try to pick different styles of wines whenever I do tastings down here so that people who are coming in will usually find at least one thing that they've never tried before.
Mm-hmm.
So tonight we were doing a Cremant Brut from the south of France. Which is made in the style similar to Champagne, but it doesn't come from the Champagne region, so it's not called Champagne. And that was the wine is called Amplexus, and it's imported by the Toad Hollow Winery in California. Then we moved into a Sauvignon Blanc from Sonoma County that's made at the Matanzas Creek Winery. We had the Freemark Abbey Napa Valley Chardonnay, and then two red wines. We did Cambria... They're Julia's Vineyard Pinot Noir from the Santa Maria Valley in California.
I like Pinot Noir.
Pinot Noirs are great.
I've had those before. I've liked them.
Yep. Somebody asked me tonight, actually, not to digress, but which one is your favorite? And I said, well, I like all the wines for different reasons, but if I had to pick one, it would be the Pinot Noir. So.
Yeah.
Nice. And then the last wine that we had tonight was Ed Mead's Zinfandel from Mendocino County in Northern California.
Okay. Nice. Well, you obviously know what you're talking about. So anything else you want to add here, Duncan?
I was curious, where are you going to be next? I mean, if people wanted to see you and your talents and everything, where are you going to be that people could experience Sharon and all her wisdom?
How can we stalk you, basically, is what we're asking.
Sharon!
Right. I pop up all over the East Valley. I'm actually... doing a tasting here soon at the AJ's at Val Vista and Baseline. And then I frequent here at least twice a month and any number of restaurants around town. My territory, I cover fine wine restaurants from Ahwatukee all the way to Gold Canyon, Tempe and Mesa, down to South Chandler and Santan. So you just never know where you're going to see me, but I always have wine.
She's like, where's Waldo, but it's where's Sharon.
Right.
So how many hours do you put into this job a week? Is this a full-time gig for you?
It is a full-time job. Sometimes it feels like two jobs, but I spend half the time I'm working drinking, so it's not so bad.
Right. Could be worse.
It could be way worse.
Yes.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, Sharon, I want to thank you so much for coming in and hanging out with us and, you know, throwing a little bit of enlightenment towards our way when it comes to wine. And, you know, you never know. We might be able to work something out where we can have you on again as a guest.
Oh, that would be wonderful. I had a lot of fun. Thank you for having me.
Phoenix Brewing Supply is an online retailer based in the Phoenix metro area. This online shop is geared up to give the home brewer competitive prices on a wide selection of all of your home brewing needs. Phoenix Brewing Supply provides quick access to a variety of hops, yeast, additives, and adjuncts, spiral fermenters, five-star chemicals, chillers, draft equipment, plumbing, and hardware are all products you can find at the click of a button. When you can get most orders shipped within one business day, why go anywhere else? Log on to phoenixbrewingsupply.com today and receive 10% off of your first order when you register online. Phoenix Brewing Supply, what are you brewing today?